Warmly welcome to this evening's talk on Whither Israel, that is being by two very distinguished guests, Professor Avi Shlaim and journalist and author Göran Rosenberg. We're delighted to see so many here, an engaged audience, we hope, and we would like also to hear your response after the talk. But first of all, I would like to thank the Student Association for Foreign Affairs and the Center for Middle East Studies and the Department of History and the Center for Theology and Religious Studies at Lund University, who have taken the initiative to have this evening talk, which is addressing some complex conundrums by these distinguished guests, who not only have published widely on these issues, but also debated them in public, as well as also relating, I would say, in a personal way, reflecting on the questions and the problems related to Israel, both the past, the present, and the future. I would first like to thank Avi Shlaim, who have traveled all the way from United Kingdom, Oxford. We're very, very happy to have you here. Avi Shlaim is Emeritus Professor in International Relations at Oxford University and also Fellow of the British Academy. He has published widely books and articles related to the Middle East and particularly to Israel, Palestine and Jordan. He's also very, very well known for leading the group of new Israeli historians and the path-breaking research conducted on what actually took place in 1948, based on the Israeli archives that was opened in late 1980s and provoked, and I guess Avi, you will discuss this further later on, provoked heated debates both in academia as well as internationally, since it challenged the Zionist narrative. And only to flag for one of his very important recent books, The Iron Wall, addresses the questions going back in time and what took place in 1948-49, providing an alternative and critical assessment of the time period. Göran Rosenberg, who I think many of the Swedish audience knows very well from his insightful work as a journalist, producing documentaries, articles, but also from his prolific writing of books, where Johan has produced a broad range of books related to everything from American politics to journalism to personal accounts, and most recently his book about his father's survival from Auschwitz to Södertälje in Sweden. And for this book, he was awarded the August Prize in 2012. I think one of the books that Göran probably will draw upon tonight is his book, The Förlorade Landet, The Lost Country in translation, which is both a personal account as well as an excellent overview of the philosophical foundation of a lot of the Zionist and Jewish accounts of the Jewish question. And many of your books has also been published, I think, in several other languages. So today we're going to discuss and reflect, and you will provide your analysis of Whither Israel. And this relates to really the complexities of Israeli politics related to questions about peace, war, security, state-making, identity politics, existential questions. And I think many of us here are curious about these conundrums. I mean, the Middle East is a conflict-ridden region. We have the Arab Spring turning to what can be described as a winter today with a stalled democratization process. We have very severe regional rivalry between Saudi Arabia and Iran, and not least the ongoing human catastrophe in Syria, the war going on there still, and we can also feel the repercussions here in Sweden as elsewhere. And of course, there's also lots of questions to be related to the collapse of the peace process. Where now for the two-state solution? Is the status quo sustainable? What are the alternatives? And also, basically, talking about an emphasis on history, present, and the future relates to the contested Palestinian and Israeli narratives about the conflict and how this can be accounted for, bridged, overcome. So there's a long list of questions, and I'm sure we cannot maybe address all of them today. But again, thanks very much for coming here, and I would first give the floor to Professor Avi Shlaim, who will give his reflection about the history and the present and the future on Israel. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Karin, for your very informative introduction. I am very happy to share a platform with you and with my good friend, Göran. I would like to join you in thanking all the different organizations that cooperated in making possible this public discussion, and above all, to thank the Student Union for acting as our host this evening. I'm a historian, and therefore I am more comfortable in dealing with the past and the present than in speculating about the future. And my main research interest is the Arab-Israeli conflict, and in the university this morning we had a seminar on the history. And today I'm not going to give an academic presentation. In my introductory remarks, I'd like to do two things. One is to provide some sort of historical context for the discussion that we are going to have later on about Israel's future. And secondly, I'd like to begin with some personal, on a personal note, because I'm not a distant observer and analyst of this conflict. I've been involved personally in the Arab-Israeli conflict since I was born. And I was born in Baghdad 70 years ago to a Jewish family. So my first identity was that of an Arab Jew. At home, we spoke Arabic. My parents' music was Arabic music. And because of circumstances beyond our control, 5 years later, in 1950, when I was 5 years old, we ended up in Israel. Zionism was a European project. It had very little appeal to the Jews of the Arab lands. It had no appeal whatsoever to my parents. But after the first Arab-Israeli war in 1948, there was a backlash against the Jews in Iraq. And as a result of that, there was a major Jewish exodus from Iraq to Israel, and we were part of that exodus. And I grew up in Israel. Now, Zionism had its consequences. There were victims as a result of the success of the Zionist movement's project of building a Jewish state in Palestine. The most obvious victims were the Palestinians, and they are the victims until today. But there is another group of people who are usually forgotten, and that is the Jews of Arab lands. So in 1948, there were 730,000 Palestinian refugees who ended up as homeless, and there were 850,000 Jews from the Arab lands who were forced to leave their countries of origin. So I wouldn't describe my family and myself as refugees in the same sense that the Palestinians were, but in a very real sense, my family and I are victims of the Arab-Israeli conflict. When I grew up, I'd hoped that the Oriental Jews, the Jews from Iraq and other Arab countries, would be used by Israeli society as a bridge between Israel and the neighboring Arab states. But this never ever happened. On the contrary, the Jews from Arab lands in Israel were co-opted in the nationalist project of building a Jewish state. And the emphasis all the way through was on us and them, we and the Arab enemies. And the Jews from Arab lands came under tremendous pressure to conform and to be part of we, part of the Zionist project against the entire surrounding Arab world. 1967, the June 1967 war, was a watershed in the Arab-Israeli conflict, and it was also a watershed for me personally, because I did national service in the IDF in the mid-1960s. When the June 1967 war broke out, I was a first-year history student at Cambridge. When I was a soldier, I served in the IDF loyally and proudly. But after the victory in that war, everything changed. Israeli society was completely transformed, and my little army was also changed. I served loyally in that army because in my time, it was true to its name. It was the Israel Defense Force. After the victory, Israel became a colonial power, and the IDF was transformed into the brutal police force of a brutal colonial power. The next watershed that I would like to single out is the Oslo Agreement of 1993. The Oslo Agreement was deeply flawed, but for all its shortcomings, it marked a historic breakthrough in the conflict because it was the first agreement between the two principal parties to the conflict, Israelis and Palestinians. I regarded it at the time almost with euphoria as the beginning of the solution to this tragic conflict. But it was not to be, because Yitzhak Rabin was assassinated, and a year later there was an election. The Likud came to power under the leadership of Benjamin Netanyahu. This was his first term in office from 1996 to 1999. And Netanyahu never concealed his hostility to the Oslo Agreement. And he spent his first term in office in a successful attempt to undermine, to arrest, and to subvert the Oslo Accords. In the year 2000, the Oslo peace process broke down. Why did it break down? The official explanation is either that it was doomed to failure from the start, or that it was the Palestinian resort to violence which destroyed the peace process. My explanation is different. My explanation is that the Likud, that rather Israel, following the return to power of the Likud, reneged on its part of the bargain. And if you want to press me to give a more precise reason for the breakdown of the Oslo peace process, I can do that in one word: settlements. Jewish settlements in the occupied territories. Jewish settlements in the occupied territories are about land grabbing. And land grabbing and peacemaking don't go together. It's one or the other. And by expanding settlements, and Israel is still expanding settlements as we speak now, by expanding settlements, Israel has clearly opted for land grabbing at the expense of peace with the Palestinians. Following the outbreak of the Second Intifada, which Ariel Sharon himself provoked, he was elected as prime minister in 2001. And Ariel Sharon never believed in negotiations with the Palestinians. He didn't think there was a diplomatic solution, a peaceful solution to this conflict. He was the proponent of the doctrine of permanent conflict. He was the unilateralist par excellence. And even when he disengaged from Gaza in 2005, it wasn't part of a broader peace process. It was a unilateral Israeli move undertaken in purely selfish Israeli interests. And it was a prelude not to further Israeli withdrawals from the West Bank, but on the contrary, it was a prelude to the consolidation of Israel's permanent control over the West Bank. And in this respect, Benjamin Netanyahu is the true heir to Ariel Sharon. Benjamin Netanyahu is now in his fourth term as prime minister, and he heads a coalition government which is the most right-wing, the most nationalistic, the most xenophobic, the most intolerant, and the most overtly racist government in Israel's entire history. There was a time when Netanyahu claimed that he believed in a two-state solution. But in the run-up to the last election, he came clean and he said that he would never agree to an independent Palestinian state, and there will not be a Palestinian state on his watch. So we have to take him at his word. And all the... So Netanyahu and his Likud colleagues, and now, ironically, he's the moderate within the Likud. Most of the Likud members of the Knesset are well to the right of Netanyahu. So Netanyahu, his party, and the coalition partners reject openly a two-state solution. They recognize only Jewish rights over the whole of the land of Israel, which includes the West Bank. They don't recognize any Palestinian national rights in this territory. And I would summarize the foreign policy of the Netanyahu government in one word: politicide. Politicide means denying the Palestinians any independent existence in Palestine. Furthermore, the Netanyahu government isn't just rejectionist in its approach to the Palestinians. It's also increasingly repressive in its treatment of its own citizens. Increasingly repressive and racist. And I'll just give you two examples of this growing repression by the Netanyahu government. One is that the campaign that it is leading against moderate left-wing NGOs in Israel. And there are very admirable NGOs, human rights NGOs like B'Tselem and others. The government is now has introduced legislation in order to curb and sabotage the work of these NGOs and to make it illegal for them to raise money from abroad in order to pursue their activities in Israel. And the other example is something that happened last week. There is an Israel state archive, and Israel used to have a very liberal policy for the release of official documents after 30 years. Now, by an edict of the Prime Minister's office, this archive is being closed. And it was no longer be possible for scholars like my fellow new historians and myself to go and examine Israel's documentary record. And it's worse than that because the documents have been declassified in the past. Now, although the archive is being closed, the military censor will be given a chance to go over all the documents that had been declassified and reclassify them. So the trend in Israeli politics today, well, the trend since for the last 15 years, has been a steady shift to the right. And I would go further and say that the trend in Israeli politics today, is a trend towards fascism. And I define fascism is putting the interests of the nation above the law and above morality. I'd like to make one more point about democracy. Israel has always prided itself on being an island of democracy in a sea of authoritarianism. But if you examine Israel's record, you'll find out that Israel has never done anything to promote democracy on the Arab side, and Israel has done a great deal to undermine democracy on the Palestinian side. So if we look at Israel today within its original borders, it's a democracy. It's a flawed democracy, to be sure, with a lot of serious discrimination against Palestinian Israelis. But if we look at the whole area from the river to the sea, it's most emphatically is not a democracy. It's an ethnocracy in which one ethnic group, the Jews, dominate the whole of that area. And there is a very, very clear cleavage and division between us and them, between the Jewish rulers of this area and the Palestinian subjects. So to sum up, if you want to understand my disenchantment with the state of Israel, one way to do it is to look at the Declaration of Independence of 1948, and contrast it with present-day Israel. And the Declaration of Independence of 1948 promised equal rights to all citizens, regardless of their gender, religion, origins, ethnic group, or anything else. So equal rights for all the citizens. And if you contrast that with present-day Israel, Israel completely fails to measure up to these lofty ideals. And the progress, the direction that Israel is going, is not towards meeting these ideals, but towards regression from these lofty founding ideals of the state of Israel. So I would end up by saying that the Netanyahu-headed government represents the betrayal of the ideals for which Israel was founded. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Avi, for sharing both a personal account related to the topic today, as well as, I would say, your dim and somewhat pessimistic also analysis of contemporary Israeli politics. It raises really basic questions about statehood, nationhood, and about the character of the state of Israel. And now it's Göran's turn to give some of his reflection.
Well, thank you so much. I will just say, as Avi said, although I'm not an historian, it's much easier to talk about what happened than to say anything about what's going to happen. I will nevertheless try to say that too. But first of all, the question, whither Israel, where is Israel going, can be stated as an empirical question. Let's find out what's happening and then let's say something clever about that. But it can also be stated as a Jewish question. Where is Israel going in relationship to what it was meant to go? Because Israel was meant to go someplace. Israel as a state or as an idea or as a symbol was the attainment of something. Not every state has a goal. I mean, Sweden maybe has, but, you know, it changes. But Israel, like perhaps some other founded societies like the United States, really had a goal and it had expectations. And in addition, it had strong Jewish expectations. Let's say that Israel is a state of deep Jewish meaning and concern. And in that sense, it is a state that is of deep concern to me, for that simple reason that Israel is part of the cultural, traditional, historical environment from which I come. It's hard to think of any Jew that doesn't have Israel in one way or Jerusalem in one way as part of his or her heritage. It's a state, or it's a symbol, it's a notion that is created within the Jewish world of thought and experience. Of course, from there it has transmitted to the Christian world as well, since the Christian world is emanating largely from a Jewish world. So yes, Israel is of special importance to me. And so people sometimes ask me why I bother about Israel that much, although I have stopped because I'm getting so depressed. But anyway, I've done it for a large part of my life, and why I get more upset with what Israel is doing than by, let's say, whoever, anywhere, that might do worse things, if you can make such a hierarchy, then I say yes. Israel is of a larger concern to me, because it is, to a large extent, it's about who I am and where I come from. So I also share with Avi a personal relationship to the state itself. In some early years in 1960, formative years of mine, I was 13, 14, 15, I actually lived in Israel. My mother and my sister, younger sister, we emigrated in 1962. More precisely, and I lived there for 2 years. I became a young Israeli. I became a young pioneer to that. I was totally absorbed by the Zionist idea, by the narrative that was concocted by the old historians, those who were later to be challenged by Avi. And I totally, it was a very, very strong narrative, you have to say. It was a patriotic, nationalist, and visionary narrative, which also had meaning for me as a young Jewish boy, also with a recent, with my parents having survived the Holocaust. So this was a new beginning in many, many ways for me and for so many others. So I shared fully these ideas and ideals of Zionism. And I also believed in the just cause of Israel. There was no cloud on the sky yet, at least in my world. There was no one telling me that there had been crimes committed in order to create this state. And there was no such things visible to me. Largely the Nakba, which we now call the Nakba, the Arab disaster, the expulsion of the Arabs, was not visible to anyone who didn't know about it. and it was really hidden away in not only in the narrative but also in the territory itself. You couldn't see it because, as you know, 400 Arab villages were destroyed, and they were destroyed not only because for some practical purposes, I don't know, but for historical purposes, there were not to be any reminiscence of what had been. So all this I was completely and innocently and happily, I must say, also, it was a very happy time, unaware of for that. So I can testify really to the power of that narrative, and I can really appreciate the challenge it must have been for the new historians to suddenly come up and say, hey, there was other things happening here, and it was all different, and so forth and so on. Anyway, this was a narrative that squarely put the blame for the conflict on the Arab side, and which also promised, and that has to be remembered, it promised a lot to the Jews. It promised the solution to the Jewish problem, really. This was, Israel was the end of anti-Semitism, it was also the end of the diaspora as part of the solution. And it was the justified, of course, but that was not a prominent feature yet. It would become later. It was a justified and necessary, inevitable response to the Holocaust. The Holocaust had proven that only an Israeli nation state, well armed, could protect the Jewish people. All this was, of course, before 1967. I will mention 1967 as a watershed in the history of the State of Israel for many reasons. And I share, first of all, although the horrible things happened, there was somehow an acceptance internationally and, of course, internally about the legitimacy of Israel within the 49-67, depends what you say, the borders. And I was, so when Israel was challenged, attacked, or was threatened by attack, rather, Israel then attacked in 1967, I was among all those who felt that this was a mortal danger to the Jewish state, and who knows, perhaps it was, but it turned out not to be. Anyway, very soon, it also turned out that this was an historical watershed in the mindset of Israel. I think before 67, those who claimed that Israel should possess the whole of the biblical territory were considered extremists. Fascists, actually, they were called. My teacher in school, who was a Likud, who was for that party that represented these ideas, which is now ruling and far more rightist parties than that, they were considered extremist fascists to be thinking of including all of the biblical land into Israel. After 67, this immediately, and you have to remind, immediately became a prominent idea, not only among religious extremists, among mainstream politicians, among people in the Labour Party. They toyed with the idea that Israel could keep the territories, somehow eat the cake and have it, keep the territories and somehow also keep some kind of decent society and democracy. And there was a movement, I remember it very well, in the summer of 68 and then in 69, was called the movement of the whole land of Israel. And it was a secular movement, largely, and it was made up by secular politicians. I remember the wife of the former prime minister, the former president, Ben Zvi. She was very active, the wife, Ruth, I can't remember her. Anyway, at that point, I started to, that was a shock to me. All this was a shock to me. I was totally, I won't use the word brainwashed, I'm too clever, but I was totally absorbed by the Zionist idea and narrative. So to me, it was very difficult to start to question this. And it started at that point when I realized that here there were other forces at play that also somehow became an affront to me. And I also, of course, then discovered that part of the narrative that I had been fed was a lie. I write in my book about the land under the stones, and I suddenly discovered the stones. I didn't see them before. I didn't realize that the Palestinian story was there to that extent. So when I finally decided to take all this thing on, and it took me many years, I had to understand what was Israel all about? Where was it meant to go? What were the ideas that somehow created this nation? Because I felt so much a part of it. And eventually, in this book that I published first time in 96, I distinguished four meanings of Israel, or four movements that at that time in history had constituted the Zionist movement. And it wasn't a monolithic movement. It really expressed very different strands in Israeli, in Jewish thought and Jewish thinking and Jewish religion too. And first of all, one has to, there was this the modern Zionism was triggered first of all by the breakout by the emergence of modern anti-Semitism in Europe and European nationalism. So it goes really hand in hand with developments in Europe. So there was the first and perhaps most emblematic strand of Zionism, the Herzl, Theodor Herzl Zionism, that wanted to create a territorial state to solve the Jewish problem and to make of the Jews a nation like all the others. Everybody else had a nation state, the Jews should have a nation state and become a normal people after having been an abnormal people for 2,000 years. So they would also have a state. And I thought, I would say that by and large, this was a dominant feature. This was the state building form of Zionism. But it was always intertwined with other ideas. There was cultural Zionism that wanted from Israel or whatever it would become, produce a better nation, a light onto the nation, something that would fulfill a Jewish call, let's put it that way. This was the burden on the Jews, if you so wish, to be slightly a moral compass or produce something that would be something that would be good for the world as a whole. So that cultural project, the cultural Zionism, which would also produce very interesting and very progressive movements within Zionism that advocated binationalism, that advocated reconciliation with the Arabs, that recognized that the Zionist project had an Arab problem. Some didn't recognize, but they clearly recognized it all the way up till the foundation of the state. You had prominent people advocating this solution. And then you had the nationalist Zionism. The Zionists born out of resentment of Central European nationalism and oppression, the revisionist Zionism that wanted, first of all, to create a strong state on both sides of the Jordan, as it were, and the Iron Wall. The title of Avi's book is, I think, taken from the leader of the revisionist movement, Jabotinsky, who really wanted to build an iron wall against the surrounding world. So that was the movement that, when I grew up, was called the fascists among the other Zionists. And last and not least, the messianic Zionists, the religious messianism, that in the fulfillment, in the creation of the State of Israel, saw the fulfillment of the prophetic messianic dreams. And that was a minor movement in my time and before then. But as we now see, and now let me immediately jump to the present, of all these four strands of Zionism, after the creation of the state, and after 67, and after the occupation, and during the occupation, this is the strand of Zionism that has prevailed. It has fused together with nationalist Zionism, it has fused together with a country like the Herzlian Zionism, and it has totally, totally eliminated what I call cultural Zionism. It's not there for any, it doesn't play any role anymore. So what has come out of this is, from my point of view, the worst kind of Zionism possible, because it embodies all things in Judaism that I resent, and it takes away everything that attracted me to it. The kind of messianic religious or religious messianic Judaism that is now supporting and somehow symbolizing the occupation, and is giving it its ideology, its its religious legitimacy. That is a Zionism that didn't exist to that extent, or perhaps at all, before 1967, and it's now totally dominating, and it goes without resistance. It's now filling the space, the ideological space that was once taken up by other strands of Zionism. So where is Israel then going from this point of view? As I said, this development started early on. We can say it started with the ascent of the Likud to power in 77, but as I say, it started already in 68, 69, with this idea that Israel could keep the territories. There was a period of total Israeli hubris, of course, leading up to the Yom Kippur War in October 1973, which is also called that period of the Israeli Empire, because they really thought they were able to pull it off. But already in 1968, you could see occupation made permanent. We had a figure like Yeshaya Leibowitz, the professor, the prophet of the conscious of part of Judaism anyway, condemning this as idolatry, to cling to the land, to put settlements on the land, to make the land holy. This is a new form of idolatry that he strongly, strongly condemned. Well, I will not. I saw as Avi, I think, 1993 as a glimmer of hope. I saw suddenly there might be a window of opportunity opening, quite unexpectedly for my part, after so many years of Shamir and Sharon and this first Intifada. It looked really bad, and suddenly comes also unexpectedly. Yitzhak Rabin, who was a military man, is not a very, never shown any signs of that kind of flexibility. He was a labor man, but still. And I think he gets this vision that Israel must somehow accommodate to a new strategic and political situation. It was after, we have to remember, the first Gulf War in 91, with a Scud missile suddenly threatening Tel Aviv from Baghdad or from Iraq. And I think as a military man, if nothing else, he realized that those hilltops that we think are the most important things that we possess to defend ourselves are not worth that much anymore. It's a new situation. I don't know. This is my rationalization. Anyway, I saw that as absolutely something stunning happening and a possibility. I was all behind the Oslo process. And I think the Oslo process died with Rabin. It died certainly with the election of Netanyahu in 1996. And I never believed it would be revived. For that simple reason, as Avi says, settlements. You can debate these things back and forth. Who did this? Who did that? What? But the settlement project went on and on and on. So there was, on the ground, there was a progressive elimination of the chances for a two-state solution. And it was intentional on large part of the Israeli establishment. They didn't want a two-state solution. This government certainly doesn't want a two-state solution. So what we are left with, I try to not be too long, what we are now left with is a situation where, as I can see it, there is no possibility of a Palestinian state that worth its name, doesn't have the territory, doesn't have the possibilities to exist. And the Palestinians certainly don't have a partner for peace at present, because the Israeli government doesn't want them. So, but now the Israelis, and as this is what I see it, this is a suicidal Israeli regime, because it doesn't have that many options in the long run. If it thinks status quo will end forever, will last forever, which is now occupation of millions of Palestinians, an increasingly hostile or critical surroundings, not only the European, you know, the public general public opinion in the world as a whole to what is going on, but also within the Jewish world. You can see people are suddenly, many, many more are distancing themselves from the policies of Israel. There, what Israel was meant to do was to perhaps make the diaspora unnecessary, but absolutely not, or in the best case, makes it a support for Israel, which it has succeeded in doing. But what is now happening is a potential cleavage between the Judaism that is expressed in the State of Israel and the kind of Judaism that is expressed in diasporic Jewish existence, which are based on completely different value sets. Israeli Judaism is based on the ethnic isolationist, if I may say, a mindset of keeping the Jews apart, while the diasporic Jewish mindset is based on coexistence with a stranger, being a stranger among others. This is how Judaism was formed for 2,000 years. So this cleavage is happening, while in Israel we now have the evolution of an apartheid state. It's clearly an apartheid state. It's within the borders of Israel, within the control of the State of Israel. You now have a large part of the population which doesn't have the same, to which is not applied the same system of justice, that has no justice. And the border between, you know, the West Bank and Israel is not the border, because you have the settlers within the West Bank who have another form of justice than the Palestinians. So by all criteria, this is an apartheid state. And we know that the world in the long run will not tolerate an apartheid state. So Israel is faced with a status quo that is intolerable in the eyes of public opinion, in the eyes of most of the world. It has undermined the two-state solution by its own actions. And what is the options remaining is a one-state solution. I haven't advocated a one-state solution because I don't see how that can happen immediately. I think that I would have loved that to happen, or at least have a state with where Jews and Palestinians and everybody would sort of be equal, and one man, one vote, and so forth and so on. But knowing the history, knowing the past, knowing the resentment, knowing the injustice, knowing everything, we all know that a one-state solution, if it were happen tomorrow, would be an invitation to civil war or something like that. So what we have to contemplate, and this will be my end note, are transition strategies towards, and this is a very optimistic me, I think it's going down the drain, but that's a very optimistic me, because status quo can prevail, and we will get a situation that is just terrible, and it will continue. But if we want to have a positive spin on this, and I really want to have that, we must contemplate strategies, transition strategies, in how to come close to a state where territorial separation, which is anyway not feasible, will not be decisive of political and legal or political democracy and legal justice. I have no idea. I know there are people working on all these kinds of projects, but as long as we have these strong ideological and political forces, I would call malevolent forces, fascist forces, racist forces, in action, there is no chance that such a process can get started. The hope that the outer world, that the United States or European Union or whoever, would impose a solution, or at least impose the framework of solution, is gone. I don't think this will happen. This was also a possibility. And with the demise of the Kerry talks, it's also gone. So that was very pessimistic. Yeah, well, I've ended there anyway. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
So before we continue talking or reflecting on the present and the future and about transitional arrangement, I would like to sort of counter a little bit of the pessimistic analysis and the pessimistic endnotes here for Göran by actually going back in time and looking and trying to understand the late 1980s, early 1990s, and also maybe moving beyond the political elite. We talked about Ariel Sharon and we talked about Yitzhak Rabin and their importance for kicking off the peace process. But looking on the Israeli civil society at that time, there were in very interesting debates going on in Israeli civil society on this question about what is a Jewish state? What does it mean? How should we define it? What is the tension and how can it be resolved when we talk about democracy? There were talks, critical talks on Zionism, post-Zionism, and a lot of people argued at the time that these were sort of opening up, and it's not only in relations to the Middle East peace process that was kicked off, but it was the work by you, Avi Shlaim, and others, as well as documentaries and textbooks being produced in Israel. So what I would like to pose as a question to you, how do you explain that? What were these forces? And I think we need sometimes also look on these other forces, not only the ones who are sort of feeding into the sort of pessimistic path that we are seeing now, but what was actually critically going on at that time that opened up space in Israel, in the education system, in relations to the political process, and general reflections about what it's meant to be a Jewish and or democratic state and the role of religion. So how do we explain this? I would like to hear your view here on your analysis of why we had that opening at the time to provide some maybe lessons learned that is important for the future. Avi, would you like to go first?
Yes, I would. You talked about the changes that were happening in Israeli society in the late 1980s and early 1990s. The changes towards coexistence and mutual recognition happened on the Palestinian side first, and Israel only reacted to that. In November 1988, there was the Palestinian National Council meeting in Algiers, and Yasser Arafat accomplished a revolution in Palestinian political thinking. Until then, the program was a rejectionist program. The Palestinians claimed a unitary state over the whole of Palestine and denied any Jewish national rights to this land. And the means to that end was the armed struggle. In 1988, a series of resolutions were passed by the PNC to accept all UN resolutions relating to the conflict going back to the partition resolution of 1947, to accept Israel's right to exist and to abandon the armed struggle. But in Israel, there was a right-wing government headed by Yitzhak Shamir, who was a complete hardline and didn't show any flexibility. It wasn't until the Labour victory in 1992, under the leadership of Yitzhak Rabin, that changes began to happen within Israel. And I beg to differ with you, it wasn't the result of the Peace Now movement, it wasn't the result of the activities of NGOs and civil society, it was because the leadership, because Yitzhak Rabin, who had been a brutal soldier and a military man all his life, but during the first intifada, he realized that this is a political conflict and there is no military solution. It's only that recognition that enabled him to go along with the Oslo Agreement in 1993. So the change didn't happen as a result of pressure from below, but because of a change of a mindset by the leadership. And if we take a longer historical perspective, then I have to agree with Göran that the real watershed was June 1967. And after the victory, there was a convergence of religious nationalism and messianism, which saw this as a miracle, divine intervention on behalf of the Jews, and secular nationalism, and the convergence of the two fed the settlement movement, which is still going strong today. So it's this convergence of religious nationalism and secular nationalism which has dominated Israeli politics, and despite the periods of labor in power with half-hearted and unsuccessful attempts to achieve a real breakthrough, despite these periods of labor in power, the long-term trend is towards greater Israeli nationalism and rejection of the Palestinians, rejection of any Palestinian national rights to the same land.
I think the opening, as you mentioned, one has to remember first of all the years after 67. I mentioned there was all these movements for basically keeping the territories. There was always the argument that the Arabs don't want peace. There were the famous three no's, you know, in Khartoum and so forth. But anyway, this was also an ideological movement that. But it was also an interesting period because it was a period where you could believe that this was possible because you would travel. It was free travel. You can go anywhere. Palestinians could go to Tel Aviv. You know, Tel Avivians could go to any place. And it created, I think, the illusion that there is no need to make a settlement or deal with historical trauma of the conflict and so forth. Somehow you could go on. I think in this atmosphere, there was a certain openness also in the Israeli public, and you could talk about post-Zionism as a confirmation of this bliss, state of bliss somehow that had emerged. But of course, immediately as the settlement project started to bite, And you get reactions, of course, that accelerated after 77 with the Likud coming to power, and not least with Ariel Sharon running amok on the West Bank because he was the Minister of Agriculture and he had his Green Brigade and did horrible things to Palestinian lands. And I mean, there was really an aggressiveness in what was taking place. And I remember I write in my book, I was traveling in the early 80s on the West Bank with a good friend, and we were sitting in Bir Zeit, and suddenly we saw these white lights, which are distinct from the Palestinian or yellow lights, because these are the lights of the and these were the new settlements, Bet El, Ofra, whatever they are. And I said, these are the dragon seeds of the occupation. And I think from that point of view, I think a window closed. But you are right in a sense that as long as there was this hope for a solution, and that hope did really not die until the second intifada, the hope. I mean, when there was a movement in Israel that somehow could legitimately and with some credibility say, we have a solution to the problem, where there is so and so and so on. Then there was an intellectual, perhaps, and a cultural climate for it, post-Zionism or whatever. But what happened in 2000, and with Barak saying there is no partner, Palestinian partner for peace, was that it somehow made it killed everything. I mean, there it killed the left. Whatever was left of the left, it died there. And one can always discuss whether the alternatives of the Zionist left were real alternatives or they were sort of making this illusion that you could have the cake and eat it, which is my take sometimes, because the true sacrifices were never put on the table, like stop the settlements, like try to deal with the refugee issue, try to recognize the Nakba, and many things that you would have to do was never on the map, which, you know, it wasn't serious always.
Thanks. I would like to raise only one question here also in regards to the responsibility of the international community and the engagement, the international engagement. And of course, being now here in Sweden, we have the Swedish recognition of Palestine. We also have deep concerns of the Israeli government when it comes to what is seen as a battle, a diplomatic battle of legitimacy at the same time. So what is your view here of the international community? Göran, you mentioned briefly here that you're quite pessimistic about any kind of international intervention, but what is the responsibility and what could be a constructive engagement? Because obviously there's concerns also by the Israeli government that they're losing out on international legitimacy. So...
As long as the Israelis believe they don't need that much, or they can somehow, they have put themselves also in a victim position, that the word is doing Israel an injustice, or that everything that the word says is actually unfair or it's anti-Semitic even, then of course it won't bite, it won't have an effect. I'm in that sense also pessimistic, because what we normally expect international reactions to achieve is a change for the better. So you are pressed and you will... I'm not so sure this is happening. I think all the reactions are legitimate because Israel is breaking so many, you know, rules in the book, in the international law, that's going on for a long time. So it's all warranted to, and the EU now has regulations for products. Occupation is illegal. It's stated by everyone. Settlements are illegal. Everything is sort of plain there. But the problem is that the only nation that I think would have been able to pressure from abroad or from outside Israel to accommodation, and that would have been a very hard-handed pressure. It would involve guarantee. I have figured out what the United States perhaps might have needed to do in order to change the Israeli politics. The only thing, EU will not be able to do that, and no one else either, as far as I see, because the Israeli mindset, the Israeli self-perception, and also the Israeli, and it has to do with Jewish history. It has to do with Jewish fears. It has to do with anti-Semitism. It has to do with the Holocaust. These are things that can be politically used and abused to strengthen and fortify an isolationist, self-righteous position. And so far, this is what is happening.
Avi, do you share that assessment?
The late Pope Paul John II maintained that there are only two possible solutions to the Arab-Israeli conflict, the realistic and the miraculous. The realistic solution was divine intervention. And the miraculous was a voluntary agreement between the parties themselves. And that's the conundrum.
Yeah.
The asymmetry of power between Israel and the Palestinians is so huge that it completely precludes the possibility of a negotiated agreement, of a voluntary agreement. So in order to have a solution to this conflict, there has to be intervention by a third party. And that third party should be the international community working through the United Nations. But the United States has sidelined the Soviet Union during the Cold War, the United Nations all along, and the European Union as well. The United States has arrogated, since 1967, the United States has arrogated to itself a monopoly over the diplomacy surrounding the Arab-Israeli conflict. But it hasn't done anything with it. The American-sponsored peace process that has gone on since 1991 is a charade. It's all process and no peace. And it's worse than a charade because the semblance of peace negotiations gave Israel just the cover that it needed in order to pursue its aggressive colonial project on the West Bank. The Americans have always posed as the honest broker, but because of their partiality to Israel, they've been a dishonest broker. So instead of America redressing the balance between the two parties by backing the Palestinians, America has added its weight to the Israeli side of the scales and thereby accentuated the asymmetry of power. That's where we are today. That's why we haven't got even a semblance of a peace process. Where does that leave us? Well, the international community is an amorphous concept. It cannot bring direct pressure to bear on Israel. The United Nations is still sidelined. One potential actor is European Union, which has the leverage with Israel because most of Israel's trade is not with America, it's with European Union. So the European Union has the leverage, but it has failed to exercise it. So the dilemma can be summed up by saying that the European Union is a payer, but not a player. It's the main provider of foreign aid to the Palestinian Authority, but it's not a real player in trying to resolve this conflict. So the international community has failed in its responsibility towards the Palestinians.
Thank you. I think we will open up for questions now. I'm sure that lots of people here are having questions that you would like to pose to Göran and Avi. So we have one question up here. Yes, please. Hello? You have to speak up. Unfortunately, we don't have a microphone, but I can translate. I repeat the question. So.
Okay.
Okay. You have mentioned the 1967 occupation as a beginning of a colonization. I would like to hear your reasoning for why 1948, which was also a certain occupation with a military rule, as we know from 1948 to 66, was not such. And the second part of the question is, or another question is, regarding this international failure that you were just mentioning, and whilst Mr. Rosenberg, you are mentioning that the EU is sanctioning Israel for the settlement product, that's a very symbolic sanctioning, I mean marking product. At the same time, Laszlo Arneson, just a few days ago, he said, in an anti-BDS gathering in Israel, that settlement products are welcome in Europe. So Europe can do this. Now the question is, what do you two think about the movement that is occurring in these times, apparently in a response to this international failure, the grassroots movement that is called BDS, that has been growing in the last more than 10 years. Thank you.
Okay, so only briefly summarize what's the difference actually from 1967 onwards in contrast to the settlements from 1948 in regards to colonialism and as a colonial project. And the second question related to the BDS and the grassroots mobilization that we see presently on the international arena right now. So, well, that's a few challenging question, I think, to both of you. So,
I'm a pensioner, so I can only cope with one question at a time. So I'll answer your first question, which is, why do I say that Israel after 1967 was a colonial power when it was a colonial power from the beginning? And I concede readily your claim that from the beginning and before Israel was established, the Zionist movement was a colonial movement allied to a European colonial country, Britain, namely Britain. And the Zionist movement would have never been able to achieve its objective without the support of the colonial power. And there have been many British betrayals of the Palestinians from Balfour to Tony Blair. But the fact is that the State of Israel was established in 1948. It was established on the basis of a UN resolution. And at the end of the fighting, Israel signed armistice agreements with all its Arab neighbors. And these are the borders, the only recognized, internationally recognized borders that Israel has ever had. And these are the only borders that I still recognize, accept as legitimate. And I totally reject the Zionist colonial project beyond the Green Line. But I agree with you that the entire thing was a colonial project, and yet in 1949, Israel had been proclaimed, it won the war, and it expanded its territory, and in May 1949, Israel was accepted as a member of the United Nations. And a French philosopher once said, on ne demande pas à une nation pourquoi elle existe. You don't ask a nation why it exists. Israel was established in 1948. The establishment of the State of Israel involved a monumental injustice to the Palestinians. But I still accept Israel as legitimate within its original borders.
Well, I will then, I'm also a pensioner, so I can also take one question. I'll take the second one, and the BDS question. It's a tricky question. On one hand, I'm encouraged to see that what's happening in Israel is stirring reactions, because it is upsetting in many ways, and I'm glad to see that it's also stirring reactions among Jews in the diaspora. There are also Jewish organizations that now are active and participating in this, and I see this as very healthy development. That's on one hand. On the other hand, I think this particular situation, or this particular nation, with all its baggage of, you know, history and propaganda and experience and well, let's put it, Israel is in one way creating for itself a kind of ghetto again, you know, with walls against the world. And it's very easy to stir among those within inside the wall that the world is again at us. So BDS is by Israel and by Israelis to a large extent perceived as that. So if you want to see, if you want to think of BDS as something that can have effect, that it can change, actually make a difference on the ground, then I'm doubtful. On the contrary, I think that it might harden the worst elements within the Israeli society. Having said that, I cannot argue, you know, against it, because I can understand the sentiments. Although I also have to say that within the BDS movement, one should be cautious, also be very cautious about how one goes about this, what terminology one uses, how one with whom one, you know, makes alliances. There are all kinds of people there out there for many reasons want to get at the Jews, let's put it that way. So it's a very complex thing, and I'm sitting there on the fence a little bit myself.
Explain also with BDS, it's boycott, divestment, and sanctions. The ones.
We haven't explained what it really means, and I don't know exactly the whole range of it. So we can perhaps someone can. Yeah.
Yes, it's a mobilization. We have a few other questions here, please. No, so I can translate as well.
They can be also.
So I will översätta nu lite. Thank you very much. Tack så mycket. So the question is really about the responsibility by the US and Europe in their support of Israel, and why not Europe is exercising greater leverage, power, coercive power against Israel. And also the other question related, you could say, like war by proxy, it's like it's actually Europe and Americans behind some of the wars, like in 1956, that you know very well. And as being a Cold War scholar, I'm sure that you can maybe provide some answers, and we will maybe be able to make some translation here later on by the one beside here. But it's really about primarily about the responsibility of Europe and the US in their support, unconditional support, I would say, in relations to the state of Israel.
So I'd like to differentiate between American support for Israel and European support for Israel. American support is unconditional. That's the problem. Israel is totally dependent on the United States economically, militarily, and for diplomatic protection. But American support on Israel isn't conditional on good behavior. Israel can do whatever it likes, and it can still enjoy unlimited American support. Israel gets away literally with murder because of American support for Israel. Since 1978, the United States has exercised the veto on the Security Council 44 times to defeat resolutions that weren't to Israel's liking. So in effect, Israel wields the veto on the Security Council. It doesn't exercise it directly, but through a proxy, the proxy being the United States of America. Europe is a different story. European Union has a very coherent and consistent policy of opposing the occupation and supporting a two-state solution. That's the declared policy. But Europe is not a unitary actor. Europe consists of 28 members. And within this group, Israel has a number of very solid allies. Germany, the Netherlands, the Czech Republic. And every time there is a resolution to punish Israel, to use economic sanctions against Israel, Israel mobilizes one of its friends to veto the resolution. That's why EU is ineffective. And it's a very great pity that EU is so ineffective in bringing pressure to bear on Israel, because Israel has a trade association agreement with EU, which is extremely favorable to Israel, and which Israel abuses all the time, because the settlements are illegal. The produce of the settlements is sold in Europe as Israeli produce. And EU has tried to force Israel to label settlement products, but the Israelis have been able to resist that pressure. And the preamble to the association agreement says that Israel must respect the human rights of all the citizens under all the people under its rule. And it would be perfectly reasonable for EU to say to Israel, you systematically abuse the human rights of the Palestinians under your rule. Therefore, we suspend the entire association agreement until you live up to your side of the deal. This is what I would like EU to do, but because of its internal character as a coalition of as a group of states rather than a single state, it has not been able to use that leverage, and it has not been able to change itself and its standing in this conflict from that of a pair into that of a player.
Can I add to this a little bit more about my take on the difference between the relationship or the support of the United States, unconditional support for Israel, and the support of Europe? And you mentioned specifically nations that are within Europe that are more sort of consistently uncritical in their position versus Israel, Germany, or most prominently. And everyone knows why this is so. I mean, Europe has an historical obligation, let's put it, or bad conscience, or whatever. Israel is created by Europe to a large extent. So there is the policies of Europe, or the policies of European nations, are largely, I think, still, but lesser and lesser, determined by historical events. With the United States, it's not so. United States is a strange thing. I happen to know a bit about the place, and I'm still puzzled by it. But there is something that that is triggered, I think, after 67, perhaps for the same reasons as it triggered this messianic movement in Israel. That's where Israel's support shifts from Europe, from France, basically, when it comes to weapons, to the United States. And also the political support that suddenly comes wasn't there all the time, wasn't there in the 50s and the early 60s. So I think we see an ideological support of a kind that is a bit, we don't understand, but I think many Americans perceive Israel as a kind of sister country, the same nature, same kind of country. They are also, by the way, have a colonial past, so they know a little bit about that. They are also a promised land. They also have these messianic ideas about themselves. And of course, there is a large constituency for this view of Israel within the Christian, what we call the Christian, the evangelical Christians, a large constituency in the United States. So there are more to this than raison d'etat. This is even not raison d'etat. People wonder why the United States is doing this at the expense of other interests that they have. So one has to count in, I think, these kinds of factors in explaining the relationship between in Israel and Europe on one hand and the United States on the other hand.
Okay, thank you. We have a question down there.
Also do have some voting status, which is why the rhetoric that Netanyahu used at the last election was so important. And likewise, you have Arab members of the Supreme Court. So you do have this kind of slightly mixed system, which is not to undermine or negate the issues in any way, but just, is it not slightly too easy to superimpose a term used from another system? And that plays into the kind of alienating the slightly more liberal, progressive members of Israeli society.
Okay, only repeating very quickly the question. So, is it helpful that the UN is producing and voting through, and I guess it's primarily the General Assembly, the disproportionate amount of resolution that is perceived in Israel and by the Israeli government as being against Israel? So this feeds into this narrative that we talked about of being the whole world is against us. That's the first question. And the second one related to the terminology of using apartheid and if you actually can make that parallel because the reference obviously is South Africa and the experience in South Africa, and the question related to the uniqueness of the state of Israel, and if that is constructive to do. So, Johan, would you like to respond
since you mentioned the apartheid, since I used it? No, I think you are mixing up things. The apartheid description applies to Israel and the occupied territories. Of course, within Israel proper, there is no apartheid. There is still ethnocracy, as I would argue, because there are a lot of laws and things that make difference between people and people. But by and large, of course, you don't have an apartheid system within the proper Israel. But if you look at Israel in the territory it controls now, I wouldn't hesitate a moment. I like the term because it is provocative. It is telling Israelis, look what you are creating here. And you are creating a system with totally a society with wholly different legal systems, or rather, if you would call the military rule on the West Bank for a legal system, but it's an arbitrary system. And of course, I'm not talking that there are separate. The physical separation based on ethnicity is appalling. I mean, people are not allowed to move to certain places. And this is not for security reasons only, believe me. So there is, in my view, no hesitation whatsoever that term applies. Of course, South Africa was something else, but I think that the terminology is loaded, and I want it to be loaded because we are dealing with something that needs to be you must find a word, and this the associations that go with the word apartment, there's none of them that I don't think apply to the present situation in Israel. Perhaps park benches and all these things, but that doesn't matter because they are not even living in proximity. They are separated spatially now, based on ethnicity and you know all this. And now recently we had, there was a spat in Israel where one member of parliament, who actually have been one of the co-speakers of the parliament, expressed that he didn't want his wife to give birth to her child in a warden where there were Arabs, because they could depurify or whatever soil the pure Jewish baby that we're giving birth to. What do we call these things? I mean, what are the words we can use for such opinions? I don't know. I'm not saying that they are not criticized. I'm saying these things, this is a member of the parliament, we have other things. I mean, but I'm not saying that this is a part, but we have opinions of this kind now, and these are opinions that are fermenting in this kind of society, is in my view.
And Avi, would you like to take on the UN quest?
Three points: victims, the UN, and apartheid. Israeli spokesman always poses the victim to this day. And Israel, the reality is that Israel is the fourth most powerful military force in the world. And the Palestinians are totally insignificant as a military force. They don't pose any threat to Israel's basic security. So the real victims of this conflict are not the Israelis, it's the Palestinians. And the Palestinians were subjected by Israel to the Nakba of 1948, to the catastrophe. And the Nakba wasn't a one-off event. It was the dispersal and the dispossession and the ethnic cleansing of Palestine, a process that continues to this very day. So the Palestinians are the victims. Secondly, the United Nations. The United Nations simply reports the reality on the ground, and the reality is a very ugly one of Israeli oppression, of Israeli aggression against the Palestinians, of Israeli violence against Palestinian civilians. And in the last 7 years, there have been three Israeli assaults on Gaza, not against Hamas, but vicious assaults on the people of Gaza with massive destruction and very heavy casualties. The United Nations had a study group to look into Operation Cast Lead of 2008 and 2009. The inquiry was led by a Jewish and Zionist individual, Judge Richard Goldstone, and the group produced the report, 575 pages, which is the highest level of international reporting on a conflict that I've ever seen. And the report documents 36 episodes, many of them amounting to war crimes. And there are 7 episodes in which Israeli soldiers shot at Palestinian civilians holding a white flag. So Israel has committed war crimes in Gaza, not once, not twice, but on a massive scale, and that is the pattern of Israeli actions in Gaza, war crimes. And the United Nations simply noted the report and took no action on it. So I disagree with you that the problem is that the United Nations is biased against Israel. The real problem is that the United Nations sees the reality for what it is, but is toothless and ineffectual in reining in and curbing Israel. And the last point concerns apartheid. Apartheid in Israel and the West Bank is a reality. On the West Bank, there are two systems of law. Palestinians are subject to Israeli military jurisdiction, and the settlers are subject only to Israeli law. And Palestinians don't have equal rights. In fact, they have no rights on the West Bank. They are ruled by a very extensive Israeli civil and military administration. And Israel is a control-freak state. It controls every detail of Palestinian life. And the checkpoints, over 500 checkpoints on the West Bank. There are settlements everywhere. I was there very recently, and I was horrified by the reality that I saw of Israel's complete control of the West Bank, settlements sprouting everywhere, the wall, the so-called security wall, dividing Palestinian areas from Jewish-controlled areas. There are roads, there is infrastructure, and there are roads which are for the exclusive use of the settlers. So Palestinians are not allowed to use some of the roads. And if this is not apartheid, I don't know what is.
Thank you, Avi. Maybe only to make the point that also in the West Bank, I mean, you have the area A, B, and C. So the Israeli military control in area C, and you have area A and partial Palestinian control in area B as well, the Palestinian Authority. And then, of course, we can discuss to what extent they have the full control in area A, of course. We have a few questions, and I will actually ask you to be very crisp, and we will maybe get all the questions, and you can sort of make a synthesis of that, because we are getting closer to time to end. So I have one question there, and then another one there, and try to be crisp and to the point when it comes to the questions.
Construction, one state construction, sooner or later. Can there be any alternative to this process, given what you said about settlements and so on, than that one? And that's irrespective of intervention from different parts of the conflict.
Thank you. So only to repeat the question, so it's about history and how it's gravitated towards one state, and to what extent that will be. We had another question down there. Yes, thanks.
They have like an underlying land to
Basically, if I understand you correctly, is that it's the non-existence of the state of Israel and the non-sort of legitimacy of ever recognizing an Israeli Jewish state as such, and you also proclaiming that would stay on forever, cease to exist. So, do we have any other question? Yes, so we have one down there, yes? Yes, so the question really relates to the increasing critique against the state of Israel and how that may feed into anti-Semitism, if I understand it correctly. And then the final last question, there was somebody down there. Yes, please. Raising an interesting question about social justice internally in Israeli society, which actually brings back to the big demonstrations that we saw a couple of years ago, but really about the poverty question in Israel and if that is a way of getting political mobilization. So I would let you both respond to these questions and maybe also to think about how you tie it all together as the end of this talk. So, Avi, would you like to go first?
Thank you. I would just like to focus on the first two questions. One is about the nature of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, and the other, the first question, was about whither Israel, where do we go from here, what is the solution? And I have to express sympathy for the position by the Palestinian here, but I don't share his perspective on the nature of this conflict, because his perspective is a Palestinian nationalist perspective which involves total non-recognition and rejection of the other. And my whole critique of Israel was precisely this: us and the other. I'm interested in bridge building and in resolving the conflict rather than taking fundamentalist positions that the Jews don't have any rights to this land, this is our land, and we'll never accept the state of Israel. So that's an extreme Palestinian nationalist perspective, which I don't share. Now let me turn to where do we go from here. Most of my adult life, I supported a two-state solution, not as providing complete justice, because in this situation, perfect justice is impossible, absolute justice is impossible, because the Palestinians would never be fully satisfied with any compromise solution. So the only reasonable compromise is a two-state solution, and the Palestinians, when they signed on to Oslo, gave up the claim to 78% of mandatory Palestine in the expectation that they would gain an independent state over the remaining 22%. But it was not to be, because Israel has denied their right to national self-determination. So my views have changed about the solution, because Israel, by its policies of territorial expansion, has destroyed the basis for a two-state solution. Israel, by building settlements and the infrastructure around them, has made it impossible for a viable Palestinian state to emerge. So Israel eliminated the only remotely just solution to this conflict, And that leaves, as the only alternative that is acceptable to me, the one-state solution. A state over the whole area from the Jordan River to the sea with equal rights for all its citizens. So that's where my position is today.
Okay, thank you. Göran?
I basically share Avi's views on these two questions, so I will jump on the third one, and that where the critique of Israel is feeding anti-Semitism. And yes, it is. And let me say something about anti-Semitism today compared to anti-Semitism in the past. Anti-Semitism, by its nature, is a conspiracy theory about Jews. Jews as emblematic Jews doing things in one way or the other. It's Jews fulfilling a role, let's put it, in history and in society, and that varies from time to time, and we know that it can be malevolent and it can be murderous. And that is what makes it a bit distinct, I would say. It really doesn't have anything with what real Jews actually do and who they are and what they behave and how they behave. Now, we are now facing another situation. We are facing a Jewish state or a state that claims to be Jewish, acting in the name of the Jews, acting, embodying somehow Judaism by some. And so for the first time, people are, for the first time since in 2000 years, people are confronted with real Jews doing real things in the name of Jews. So real Jewish power, if you so wish. Now, that shouldn't lead to anti-Semitism, it should lead to criticism, it should lead to opposition, it might even lead to war, it can lead to all kinds of things as you oppose war. But the problem is that we have the anti-Semitic conspiracy theory waiting to be used to explain what's going on. So I'm not surprised that the experience of what Israel is doing can feed into anti-Semitism, and it has done so. No doubt, there is anti-Semitic versions of the Israeli occupation and the Israeli existence and whatever you have. In the Muslim world, among Palestinians, sure, there are. For the first time, you have it also corroborated in their view by what Jews actually are doing. So this is new. Now, the problem is exacerbated, I think, by the present by Israel, because, and I have to say this, it's very painful to say this, but historically, anti-Semitism has been a good friend of Zionism. Let's be frank about this. Zionism wouldn't have existed without anti-Semitism. If anti-Semitism had somehow gone away in the early 19th century, which people hoped for because Jews were liberated and became members of society, then I'm not sure there would be any Judaism today. I don't know, which one can bemoan from other reasons. So this is exploited too, and creating fear among Jews, and it's in. So we have a very dangerous idea, anti-Semitism, or a dangerous conspiracy theory, now again giving a lot of room in our societies, and it's worrisome. It's very worrisome, and it is clearly stimulated by and to some extent spurred by the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. I'm sad to have to say that as the end. I will maybe say so also where this is all going, with Israel. Yes, the two-state solution for all practical purposes is gone. And I agree completely with Avi that I hope for that to be the bridging solution to what at the end of the day would be a state where people who in any way live in such close proximity to each other would find ways to coexist without having to sort of build walls around themselves. So a two-state solution in itself must, if it was to be the first step towards a just coexistence between two people or different people in one land. I don't see this happening now. I see the one-state solution, which means democracy, one man, one vote, equal treatment for everybody, as the basis for any solution. But I'm pessimistic about how that can be achieved under the present circumstances. I'm afraid if you push this thing, you have to talk about it with some perspective. And as I said in the beginning, I think, if you can find some kind of stepwise strategy towards, with all kinds of security arrangements and this and that, constitutional things that will lead towards that, then I would, of course, support it. But we wait for this still to happen.
Okay, thank you very much, Göran. And I would only like to end on trying to at least navigate and to think about that maybe, you know, the question about justice, the questions about coexistence. We need to think more seriously about that. We talked about transitional justice. We're talking about transitional arrangements and somehow that the status quo is unsustainable. It's not sustainable in the long run. And we need to think constructively, I think, both in academia as well as in the public sector in regards to justice questions about coexistence and about peace and about recognition of each other, as you mentioned, Avi. So on that note, I would like to give a very warm applaud, and I hope you all join me in on that by having Göran and Avi sharing so generously with their wisdom, experience, and insights. It's invaluable. Thank you very much.